The views expressed on the following program are designed to amplify those of the speaker and not necessarily those of KAAM, DJRD Broadcasting, or its sponsors.
Hello, everybody!
What's coming up on today's experience? It's Dr. Dave's Devotional Diamonds of the Day, also known as DDDDDs, where my daily devotions become some of our spiritual reflections. Sound effects placed throughout the show which have nothing to do with life, but the Bible teaches there's a time to laugh. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 4. The review of the goofy news, which proves Jesus is coming back sooner than you think. Take a look around. I don't think it's that hard to figure out. Also, life lessons for our faith that we could actually use, probably won't, because we may be sitting on our blessed assurance. Humor that will force you to think, why does this guy have a radio show? Because God said I could. That's why. Also, Bible trivia for fake and yet somehow real cool prizes, your phone calls, and more. Welcome to the David Spoon Experience, local, national, and heavenly talk. My name is Dr. David Spoon, and I will be your host for the next 5,400,000 milliseconds. Get ready for one of the more bizarre experiences on live radio. Here is the key to the show. We don't know what we're doing. We have no idea what's going to happen, and we don't care. But for the next few minutes, I want to talk compassion with you. So here we go. We're asking questions about living life as a Christian. That thingy right there. And remember, it's Thursday. And on Thursday, we ask a very pointed question without reservation or hesitation. As Bible-believing, born-again Christians, are we expecting more in 2024? It's very simple. Are you anticipating a poke in the eye with a sharp stick? Or are you anticipating the grace and glory of God manifesting in your life? That is the question. What are you expecting? When you pray, do you dribble the prayer out and go, boy, I hope he heard that one? Or do you have a level of expectation that all things are possible to him that believes? Just asking the question. If you have an opinion, a comment, a thought, or a question, please don't let it die of loneliness. Reach out and give us a call. Our number here, 972-445-0770. That's 972-445-0770. And when you call 972-445-0770, well, you'll end up talking to Jammin' Jacob. Hallelujah. Listen to this. When you talk to Jammin' Jacob, I want you to know something. It is just like spending time relaxing and chillaxing. Hello.
Thank you, David. Happy Thursday.
Happy
and talking
Thursday.
To you is like not getting poked in the eye with a sharp stick.
Very good. Isn't that a good line, though? That's a great one.
It's a great line.
All right, folks, here's the bottom line. The bottom line is we want you to be blessed by the Lord. You think, what? Yeah, no, that is, you think, no, no. It's exactly what we're looking for. We want the Lord to bless you. How about that? And so you can call us during this show, and we'll see what we can do to be a blessing. You can also text us, so I want you to be aware of that. You can text 214-210-8483. That's 214-210-8483. A little softer now.
214-210-8483. 8483.
Yeah, that's right. So you can call us, you can text us, you can email us, david@hemustincrease.org. D-A-V-I-D is my name, David. Well, you don't actually have to spell it. It's just David. At, A with a circle around it, hemustincrease from John 3:30, hemustincreaseimustdecrease.org, because we're a nonprofit entity. It's pretty simple. You can call us, you can text us, you can email us. Why? Why would you do that? Well, one, it's kind of fun. Number two, the whole idea behind this is if you have an opportunity to get prayer for something, do it. Why are you not? Let's not be like Jonah, who waited until the fish swallowed him whole, then prayed. Let's pray beforehand. Let's pray up in front. Let's pray in the middle. Let's pray at the end. You're supposed to pray all the way through. That's what praying always means. That's what praying without ceasing means. In the middle, in the end, in the beginning, all the way through. And so you pray about something. You believe for it. You stand in it. You love it. You know the Lord loves you. You know he's committed to you. You got to break through some of those doubts that Satan has planted, and you've got to beat them down. That's exactly what Jesus said. Why do you doubt? Where is your faith? Because when we doubt, it takes away from the faith. So if you have an ounce of faith and an ounce of doubt, you got nothing. Can I say that again where that really gets through? Listen to what I'm saying. If you have an ounce of faith and an ounce of doubt, you have zero. That's what you have. That's how it works. And so the bottom line to this process is we want to be a blessing to you. Maybe you've got something you need prayer for. Let's pray about it. Maybe you got something you want to share a praise on. There's something that's going phenomenally. You're just really excited and just, you know, the Lord's done this. He's given me grace. He's given me a safety. He's given me a sense of peace. Do you ever go into a situation and it's like, wowzer, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. And then somewhere in between it all of a sudden there emerges this illogical, unknown, out of nowhere, left field peace. And that peace just, it passes understanding because it doesn't make any sense. But it keeps you. Hey, you know what that is? That's a praise report. That's what that is. Isn't that cool? Oh, yeah, you bet. That's cool stuff, right? So you can have a prayer request. You can have a praise report. You can have something the Lord's put on your heart and mind. Our goal here is pretty straightforward. We're not looking for any anti-Semitic remarks or any kind of goofy things like that. We're looking for people to encourage and to bless one another. That's what we're looking for. It's not overly complex, and we want you to have that freedom to do that. Now, having said all that, whether you're in San Diego or whether you're in Denver, Dallas, or Detroit, you can reach out to us literally by calling or by texting or by email. All of it's live right now because this isn't the replay yet that takes place in about, what is it, like 12 hours? It's not through. So it's in the afternoon time, okay? So here we go. I've got some teaching today that I think is some of the best teachings that we're going to cover, and we're closing in on finishing the Book of Jude. And this is such a phenomenal text that I am actually going to do something I've never done on this show before. I am going to read it in a different translation right off of my Chromebook instead of reading it out of the notes. And why? Because it's so phenomenal, I really want you to catch it, and I want to make sure I teach it well. And if I fail in any way, shape, or form, I apologize ahead of time, because I am never as good as the Word of the Living God. I'll just say that right off the bat. All right, here we go. Jude, and it's one chapter, as you know, so we do it by verses, and we're already at verse 22. Last week, we talked about the idea of keeping ourselves in the love of God as we're waiting for the mercy of Jesus, and then verse 22 comes in with this super interesting and super multi-commented portion. Here's what it says. It says this in the ESV. I'm doing that on purpose for this particular read, and have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Wow. All right, let's pick it apart piece by piece just so you can follow what we're doing here, okay? This is really important. There are three distinctions in this verse on people being reached. One is mercy on those who doubt. So in the King James, New King James, the word is compassion. On the newer translation, it's mercy. I understand. The Greek word is translated mostly mercy, but sometimes compassion. And the real answer is the word should be compassionate mercy. I'm just telling you, don't get mad. So it should be have compassionate mercy on those who doubt. And then it says save others by snatching them out of the fire. And so here's the key component. Mercy or compassion on those who doubt. There is a sense where some people hear the gospel and they just don't know. And instead of being mad at them, which many people do that, they get mad that they're, and I've actually literally been in a gym next to a guy, he's a nice guy, and he's witnessing to this other guy, doing the best he can, nothing wrong with that. And he was sharing about Christ, you know, and I'm just like, you know, kind of giving amens and so on and so forth. And the guy was like, I don't know. I got to really contemplate, I got to think about it. And the guy who was sharing, you don't know who he is, so I'm not saying anything against him personally, but the guy got mad because he didn't just say yes. Hey, you know what? That's not the response. If you're a Christian and you're sharing and you're communicating those to those and they don't quite get the reality or the truth, here's a brilliant theological message for you. Remember before you were a Christian how you were trying to figure it out? Well, think of yourself that way for them. Have compassionate mercy on them. Instead of being mad at them, pray for them. Love them. You are blessed to know the truth. God has revealed it from heaven. Blessed are you, Simon, because flesh and blood has not revealed it to you, but my Father from heaven. You are blessed because it has been revealed to you from heaven. Let's give a little space to those who aren't quite there yet. Having a compassionate, merciful attitude towards them. Being available for any other questions or any other things that they may want to inquire about. Remember, Jesus said, come and see. Isn't that just so powerful? Come check it out. Don't you think God is big enough, bigger than your presentation of the gospel, to reach somebody after you've shared it? Of course. I heard the gospel 30 times from my brother in 7 days. I said no 29. It was the 30th that made the difference. So some people, you got to have this compassionate mercy. You approach them in a different regards. But then the other part of the verse says, save others by snatching them out of the fire. And so into the earlier translation said, save them by using fear, you know, having a fear element, snatching them out of the fire. And so some people, I got a message for you. People don't like it, but some people respond well to fire and brimstone. It's the truth. You can't change that. Some people are like, yeah. Oh, yeah, no, I don't want to go there. I don't want that happening. I mean, I don't want bad stuff like that to take place. And then in the New King James, it says, save others with fear, pulling them out of the fire. And it's like, wait a minute. You're going to try and tell me that sometimes it gets really ferocious? Yes. And some people, like moi, start off in the fire insurance place. Well, I don't want to go to hell. And move from that point to, wait a minute, this is more than fire insurance. This is real stuff. And that becomes the difference for the person. So what Jude is saying is, look, you approach some people this way, you approach some people this way. In fact, the other part of the verse says, this, save others, snatching them out of fires. And then a third one says, show others mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. We'll get to that in a second. But see, the first one, save others with this mercy, who are doubting. The others, save them, you know, using the fear, snatching them out of the fire. The third one is a combo. What? It's not just one or the other. It's some people you need to be super soft with. Other people you need to tell them, look, man, it's turn or burn. It don't change. And some people need both. Well, of course. Different people are reached in different ways and in different times. But there should always be this portion of us that's like merciful, gracious, knowing that God was gracious to us to save us. The big issue is the very last part of verse 22 and 23. Have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. And then to others show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. You know what many pastors have said with that, right? Well, God, you know, God hates even the clothing connected to sin. We're going to get to the great line that goes about all the time. We'll get to that in a second. But here, I just want you to get this. Jude is advising us to detest even the garment that's stained by the flesh. This implies that anything tainted by sinful actions, anything tainted by sinful behaviors, will be incinerated before the Lord. The underlying message is that sin is repugnant and should not be tolerated in our lives or anyone else's life. And I don't think we have enough, maybe teaching in mass that says this is a very disgusting, blasphemous action, word, thought, whatever it is, that is a absolute insult to God. And it's like, I don't think we're catching that that's what was laid upon Jesus, the penalty for that. But I want to go back to this because this is a popular saying. Even the garment stained by the flesh. So what's the comment that comes from there? Well, God hates sin, but, you know, God, there's no hate in God, so he doesn't hate the sinner. He just hates the sin. First of all, that's not true the way that they present it. So let's just say that's ridiculous. And we've had political figures say God never hates. Yeah, okay. So Proverbs 16:6 says this: these six things the Lord hates, yea, seven are an abomination to him: a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift to running to evil, and a false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord amongst brethren. So there are seven things in Proverbs 6:16 that God hates. Two of them, by the way, are liars. By the way, that's not the clothing. That's the person. Just in case you're wondering. One of those is a heart that devises wicked plans. God hates that heart.
Oh, yeah, but that's not the person.
Right. That makes no sense whatsoever. Romans chapter 9, verse 13. Jacob have I loved, Esau have I hated. That's the fact. And you might be thinking, well, wait. How does that work? Well, here's how it works. God loves all his kids the same. He doesn't have favoritisms between the kids. But those that reject God are not loved. They're not maintained in that love because they're not willing to come to the Father through the Son. And so they don't get to hold that same court. And so when people say, well, it's just, he doesn't hate, there's nobody that he hates. Where is that in the book? God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. His solution for the world's rebellion is Jesus Christ. But he doesn't say, but because of that, I'm not going to have any punishment on anybody. God hates sin. And if somebody embraces sin, it ain't impressing God. So what I'm trying to distinguish here is the understanding that when we're sharing, and this is what Jude's saying. Look, some people you got to have really be compassionate. Some people you got to lay it on the line, turn or burn, heaven or hell. Some people you got to do kind of a mixture. But remember, God hates even clothing that's stained by sin from the sinner. That's the truth.
Oh, I don't like that.
Tough. Tell God. He gave an answer. Somebody asked me the other day, what's the deal? I mean, does everybody get saved? It's very simple. Because of sin in mankind, everybody's going to hell. But God has provided the lifeboat named Jesus. You either jump on board and get saved or don't and go where you're going. That's how it breaks down. Get that? Wow. I've been fire preaching in the first, the beginnings of these. I've just been like, rah, rah, rah. But this is such a great portion. Look, God reaches people in different ways at different times. And sometimes it's merciful and compassionate. Sometimes it's like, oh, fire insurance. And sometimes it's a combo. But God hates sin. Let's keep that straight. Okay, take a deep breath after I preached. It's a good thing we don't preach fire and brimstone. Taking a deep breath. Here we go. Here's our first trivia question. Get ready. You guys should get this. It's a multiple choice. I am one of the sons of Noah. Hold on. I was the father of all the Hebrews. Hold on. Am I Jephthah, Nam, or Shem? And your answer is very close to the name of one of the first four Three Stooges. Let's see if you guys can figure out that. If you can remember, okay, just going to leave that there. If you think you know the answer, reach out to us. You can call 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483. Additionally, you can send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. Going to send you up to the website and remind you about a couple of things. I'm just not even going to say it rudely or weirdly or anything. Here it is. Ready? More, please. If you can give, that would be great. I'm sorry to say it that way, but we are a little low in funds, as we always get right about this time. We get twice a month. We get to this place where it's like, uh-oh. It's always a challenge for my faith. I know that. So if you're able to give, that's great. Remember, we're not giving you a whistle, a donut, or a Lamborghini, just a receipt at the end of the year. Leaving it there. Proverbs 3:9, honor the Lord with your wealth and with the first fruits of all your produce. That's what we're commanded to do, is never give God leftovers. And I say this to you sincerely. If you can't give to us, that's fine. You still have to be a steward of what God has given you. And therefore, you need to be able to give God the best of what you have and not the least, so he receives it. You get that? All right. Additionally, on the websites, the new books. We've told you multiple times there's 5 books up there. If you want any of them, we have them in print and in ebook. We're still working on the audiobook, but simply, if you need a book and you can't afford it, tell us and we'll get it for you and send it to you. We don't care. We just think that's a better investment in the kingdom of God than any other way. Plus, there's also cool stuff on there. There's also a place to put praise reports and prayer requests. Check it out on hemustincrease.org.
Prayer request?
hemustincrease.org.
Praise report?
hemustincrease.org.
Looking to give to this ministry?
hemustincrease.org.
Confused by what's happening right now?
hemustincrease.org.
hemustincrease.org.
From the valley of the jolly,
ho, ho, ho,
green giant.
Excellent. I love that play. All right, once more on the trivia question. And I want to make sure you get this. Listen to the hint. For those that don't know, I am one of the sons of Noah. I am the father of all the Hebrews. Genesis 10, 18 through 27 would be your reference point, but it is 9 verses you got to read. Who am I? Am I Jephthah, Nahum, or Shem? And here's your hint. One of the original original foursome of the Three Stooges. This person's name is similar to that. Jephthah, Nahum, or Shem. There you go. If you think you can figure it out, you got a little bit of time, and you can just give us a call, 972-445-0770. You can also text 214-210-8483 or send an email, david@hemustincrease.org. I want to finish up on this text because we're basically finishing up on the Book of Jude, and we will be starting Revelation next Thursday. It says this in verse 24, "Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling, to present you unblemished in his glorious presence with great joy, to our only God, our Savior," referencing Jesus Christ as God, "be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority, now, both now and for all time and forevermore." So let's just talk about this. The letter is closing with what we call a doxology. It's a hymn of praise or a hymn of confession. And it's the whole point is that it's God who can keep us from stumbling. So it's important to note that God can support us in our most challenging times. And while sin may attempt to claim ownership over us, we must remember that sin originates from a place of deceit. The father of lies is Satan himself. And God can prevent us from falling, even in the face of our most persistent sins. It's just so nice to know. Oh, Lord, I keep messing up. I can help you, Dave. I keep doing this. I know, but keep coming to me. I can keep you.
I can keep you from falling in that. Oh, I'd like to do better. I know you wouldn't. I'm going to work with you. See, this is how it goes. So the letter's closing, and in its closing, it assures us that we will be presented faultless in our eternity. You're going into eternity clean as a whistle. Our sins will not accompany us into eternity. Did you hear me? Your sins will not follow you into eternity. They may deprive us of some rewards that heaven has to offer, but they're not going to prevent us from entering the gates. The closing is profound. Before all time, now and for all eternity, long after time has ceased to exist, glory, majesty, dominion belong to God, the King of the universe, through Jesus Christ. We honor the Father through the Son by the power of the Spirit. It's like so cool if we can get a grasp on it. And it's going to be so awesome. God is going to bring us into eternity, and we are going to be clean and free. I mean, how much better does it get? I submit to you, it does not. The greatest thing, it's not this 50, 60, 70, 80 years. You're going to spend eternity with God. And the bottom that you'll be standing on is gold. So you can just figure out everything else will be much better. All right, I am one of the sons of Noah. Who am I? I was the father of all the Hebrews. Am I Japheth, Nam, or Shem? One of the four Three Stooges is the clue, Genesis 10, 18 through 27. I am Shem. And for those who couldn't figure out the clue, Shemp. Larry, Moe, Curly, and Shemp. Get it? Okay, cool. All right, we're going to take our break, and then we're going to come back. You're listening to the David Spoon Experience. Right here on KAAM 770, the Truth Station here in Texas. Short break. We'll be back. Don't go anywhere.
Since the dawn of the internet, people have been looking for a website they can be proud of without costing an arm or a leg. People want a quality website to promote their ministry, business, hobby, or passion. Introducing Cowpunch Sites. Cowpunch Sites can help you create and maintain a quality website. From design to security, Cowpunch does it all. Cowpunch is a family-owned and operated business, taking a fresh approach to business. Lots of clients at lower prices. Make mom happy.
The most significant benefit of working with Cowpunch Sites is that you work with real people, not cheesy templates. No outsourcing. It's $57 a month, and there's no setup fee and no cancellation fees. When you go to cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's cowpunchsites.com/dad. That's me. Oh, did I mention that it's $57 a month? Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no bull.
Dave, this is a nice radio station.
Oops, sorry. That's Cowpunch Sites, $57 a month, and that's no baloney. There, that's better. Cowpunchsites.com/dad.
What is the David Spoon Experience?
Now, if anybody gets offended at this, I apologize that you have no sense of humor. Okay. Like that? That's a good line. Bam, bam. All right, here's the first one. A pastor was leaving his area and was saying farewell to his congregation at the church door for the last time. He shook the hand of an elderly lady as she walked out. She said, "Your successor won't be as good as you." "Well, nonsense," said the pastor in a flattered tone. "No, really," said the old lady. "I've been here under five different ministers, and each new one has been worse than the last." Ouch! Ouch! But this is the one that's going to offend people, which is irony, right? Because that's more offensive than this is, and this is just too... And if you guys get offended at this, I, you know, take a week off the show. It seems there was a minister who had just all of his remaining teeth pulled and new dentures were being made. The first Sunday, he only preached 10 minutes. The second Sunday, he preached 20 minutes. But the third Sunday, he preached an hour and 25 minutes. When asked about this by some of the congregation, he responded this way: "The first Sunday, my gums were so sore it hurt to talk. The second Sunday, my dentures were hurting a lot. The third Sunday, I accidentally grabbed my wife's dentures, and I couldn't stop talking.